Schizophrenia is a very serious mental illness. It affects about 1% of the population worldwide. And one of the interesting things about it is that it doesn't show a lot of variation from one country to another, to different racial groups, different ethnicities. So it's a real serious problem. Like many groups, we started out focusing on a particular gene. So we've got a sample of families that our collaborator in Canada has collected, Dr. Ann Bassett. And using these families, we've identified a particular gene, it's called NOS1AP, that seems to have a very important role in increasing risk in these families. Other people have looked in other families, other collections of other populations, and as is typical for our field, there are mixed results. So there's several studies where people find that this gene looks like it's important in other populations, and there are a couple of samples where people don't find any evidence for this gene. For example, we've identified one sample where if you just look at the sample by itself, you actually don't see any evidence that this gene is increasing risk. But if you then start to look at the interaction of this gene with another gene on a different chromosome, all of a sudden you see that the interaction is important and does act to increase risk. So what we've basically done most recently is we've taken our set of families, these Canadian families, and we've actually genotyped them at a million SNPs, these single nucleotide polymorphisms, across the whole genome. And what we've started to do now is look for evidence of interaction between our first gene, NOS1AP, and other genes that are in other areas of the genome that we have statistical reason to believe that there's another gene involved there. And what we've started to find out is really very, very interesting. We're identifying a set of additional genes. So we currently have five other genes, all of which are in biological pathways that interact with the first gene. So these are our second set of genes that we're pulling out that have strong statistical support that they're also increasing risk for schizophrenia. And it just so happens when we look at which genes are supported that they're biologically very closely tied to that first gene, which is, you know, what you would expect. So we're actually very, very encouraged that our method is working and that, you know, we're hoping that we'll be able to expand this to other data sets. So not just do this on our Canadian samples, but do it on groups from other backgrounds. So I think there are a few different things that hopefully this understanding will help with. So first off, there's a big push right now to this concept of personalized medicine and this idea that certain people respond, say, better to certain drugs than other people do, and can we understand the underlying genetics that causes one person to benefit from a given treatment more than another. So I think in terms of modeling who's most likely to benefit from a given therapeutic intervention, looking at multiple genes to try to determine that is going to give us a better fit and then hopefully better therapeutic outcomes. A second potential benefit from this is that we might start to identify additional potential targets for pharmacologic intervention. So many of the medications that are used for schizophrenia right now are from a relatively limited class of drugs, and they target some but not all of the symptoms of the illness. So one of the hopes is if we identify more of the underlying biology that's going wrong in this illness, we might be able to come up with some better ideas for how to treat it. A third area that this might be useful for is that we know that schizophrenia is not an entirely genetic disorder. So if you look, for example, at identical twins, it's not the case that every pair of identical twins will both have the illness. You certainly find about half the time one twin has it, the other twin doesn't. So there's something besides genes that are important in the illness. If we can identify what really causes someone to have the genetic risk factors, then that might make it easier for us to figure out what are the specific environmental factors that cause somebody to get the illness or not get the illness. And that might actually be an easier avenue of intervention to actually prevent people from getting whatever environmental exposure it is that triggers the disease. And that's probably going to be easier than, say, doing something like gene therapy to actually fix the underlying genetic deficits. It's a big puzzle. And the analogy I like to use is to say it's like a jigsaw puzzle. And when you're doing a jigsaw puzzle, once you have some of the pieces in place, it gets easier to put the subsequent pieces in place. And there's nothing wrong when you're doing a jigsaw puzzle with starting with the easy stuff, like doing the edges first. So I think in terms of going after genes that have a big effect in a given sample and then trying to see what other genes interact with those, you know, it is very analogous to you start out with a corner, then you do the edge, and then probably the environmental factors are going to be filling in the middle of the picture.